I just, yeah, I want to say thank you again, everyone, for coming and being here. And yeah, why don't we start with a question from the audience? I'll just keep on to Twitter, and we'll go. We'll see what happens.
It's not really a question, but a statement. And also, I know that there is a shortage of doctors, but if you also allow and expand naturopathic physicians, which I'm proud to be one, we are trained from the beginning about the microbiome. We're trained about with functional medicine, foundational medicine. So you really need to include naturopathic medicine, I believe, in this health wave, because this is what we've been doing, and we're trained from day one in medical school.
Absolutely. Thanks, Dr. Hume. I completely agree with that. We've got some great naturopaths in the house and on the summit, and they are doing some really incredible work, and I think that they are a good fit. The problem is there's only 6,000 of them, and we need many more. And part of the thing that we're going to do after the summit is really encourage those people that have signed up as a patient to take action and start to play their role. You know what? There's a lot of people out there that hate their jobs. And there's a lot of people that want to be part of this and don't know where to start. And I think finding a role for those people is going to be a huge part. And I'd like to see a lot more people trained in naturopathic education. There's 6 schools right now that are accredited. There may be 10 in the next few years. So it's happening. And I'm really glad you brought that up, because I'm a big fan of the naturopaths. Dr. Galland, yeah, you want to?
I think naturopathy is a great model for primary care. Yeah, I totally agree with that.
You know, it's funny with naturopaths, and maybe I could get your thoughts on this, because I do love naturopaths, but one of the things that bugs me about them is in the search to be like junior allopaths, to be like medical doctors, the naturopaths should have owned this microbiome stuff. They knew this from the beginning, and yet, you know, still killing drugs with, you know, killing microbes with herbs and so forth. I mean, do you feel like it's going to come full circle and we'll realize that germs were good and they sort of missed the boat on taking that positioning?
Well, I think that's always been part of naturopathy. I think going back to the late 19th century, naturopathy embraced the concept that the gut and digestive function was really important for health, and we're probably the first to really accept Metchnikoff's insights into the importance of lactobacilli, for example. I think the changes, none of us were in a position to foresee 20 years ago what the current research findings are in terms of the microbiome. And it really took breakthrough technologies to make it clear that this was way beyond what we had even expected. I mean, it's way beyond what I expected. And I mean, I've been doing this work for a long time. It really kind of blows me away to see what the various influences of the microbiome are just on normal development and the notion of coevolution that I talked about. I mean, I don't think any of us could have predicted this before the research actually started to indicate that there's something going on here that's way bigger than we had ever thought.
Absolutely. Have we got another question, Paula?
Hi.
Hi, Gigi.
Hi.
Another great organization, by the way, can I just say, Healthy Child, Healthy World. Gigi is the executive director.
So I heard a lot about the technology and the wearables, and I'm curious whether for the people on stage now or anybody else in the room, has there been thought around the impact of EMS and, you know, just sort of the idea of it in affecting our sleep cycles and our attention and all of that in the health? Because, you know, feels like it's a little bit of a double-edged sword.
Definitely a double-edged sword. I was on the phone to Dr. Mercola a couple of days ago, and you can't call him on his cell when he's at home because he's basically got, like, the walls that don't allow any EMFs through, so he's ahead of the game. You want to speak to that, Robin?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that there's a misperception that in advocating for the use of digital technology, you're saying that we need to have all of this stuff strapped to us at every moment and every day, and I think that that's where being conscious, and yeah, I'm all for digital detox. I'm all about getting these things away from you as much as possible. But then the other reality is that these technologies are not just going to like go away overnight. And if we can, we should use them to their maximum potential to help us live healthier lives, while at the same time being conscious of, yes, your computer screen, your iPhone, these things are disrupting your sleep. There is concern about EMFs, electromagnetic waves, and how those are impacting us. So it's not that you throw the baby out with the bathwater. You just have to do both.
Gabe, I want to ask you a little bit about empowerment, because I know you're right on the front lines dealing with people. And Gabe and I started the Functional Forum to really bring a voice to empowerment and help doctors to switch and develop the skill set from compliance to towards empowerment. You're probably dealing with these same kind of questions. For those, you know, the people who are watching, what do you think are the sort of the core things that need to happen for someone to move from sort of a compliance mindset to an empowered mindset?
Yeah, absolutely, James. So for people who have seen some of the other forums, I talked a lot about just empowering, looking, and something great doctors are doing today, but just looking to empower the patient to be engaged in the work, to care about what they're doing, to understand why they're doing it, a lot like being teachers and what we spoke about. And so, you know, one of the first steps I always take with people is to have them write down themselves personally what I'm going over with them in the session, also to ask them their input in terms of what they feel they could be doing outside of here that they're not doing. So it's always about engaging someone in their own process and helping them feel like they're a part of it. You know, so we've spoke about that before. And I think beyond that, it's a lot about asking people why. You know, why do you want to be healthier? I think, you know, yes, it's uncomfortable to have a symptom, you know, so, you know, we walk around with symptoms, we want to not feel them. But then once you feel healthy, it starts forcing people to confront different issues, like, what do you want to do with your life? What makes you happy? Are you happy with other areas? And I think you want to connect people to maybe a vision of, as to why they would take some of these actions, because we know it takes a lot of, you know, the sessions are always great, and we sit with people, and they're there, and we give them instructions, but really what happens is when they leave. What goes on in the session is important, but 99% of what goes on is when they leave. So I think helping people connect to a reason as to why they would take these steps, what their life would look like when they take those steps, what might it feel like to wake up without some of those symptoms, and what would they want to do with themselves? These are some of the questions I think more and more we have to ask. And, you know, like Robin said, people are going to be walking around with iPhones. I mean, this is going to be a process that it's not just going to be about a doctor's appointment. This is going to be about the way people live and the reason why people are choosing to live that way. So I think engaging the person and then asking them questions about their life outside and what they're going to do with it is a big part of follow through.
I think that's a great point. And Robin, do you think with the process that Gabe just described there, can that be done at scale without a person or not?
I think certainly parts of it can, and I think a lot of what we're talking about here today and a lot of the power of functional medicine can happen without a doctor necessarily being involved, whether it's a naturopath or a DO or an MD. I think that there's a lot of different people, as some of us have talked about, from health coaches to nurses to other, you know, interested people who can be part of this revolution, and it doesn't have to be hours on end with a person, or it could be hours on end, but split up among over your lifetime with lots of different people who inspire you, plus digital technology that helps you get there.
Awesome. You did hear Robin say that this is a revolution. I would just like to remind her that it's actually an evolution, because the revolution will not be televised, and we're live right now. All right. Who's next down there at the back?
Hi. This is for Dr. Galland. So for purposes of teaching the public, can you just give a brief description of what's involved in healing the microbiome? Length of time, testing, what's involved, other than just giving probiotics?
Well, first of all, diet is really important. And diet has a major impact on the composition of the microbiome. And there is no perfect diet for everybody. The concept of whole foods has been mentioned here, and I think that's really important, because diets that are manufactured and depleted of nutrients and fiber have a negative impact for the most part on the microbiome. The second is being careful about the kinds of drugs that you use, because as I mentioned in my presentation earlier, drugs can really disrupt the microbiome and the communities of the microbiomes. I think antibiotics need to be used with care. I think that the concept of acid suppression needs to be obliterated from the mass media. It is the least physiologic treatment for upper GI symptoms, and can have really disastrous long-term effects, which are getting a little bit of attention, but they're not really, they certainly are not being understood by physicians. I think the New York Times probably does a better job than medical journals of communicating them.
Yeah, that's such a good point. There's a couple of organizations right now that are doing really amazing research on the microbiome, and some of you VIPs will get to go home with a Ubiome kit where you can test your microbiome individually for under $100. It's really amazing. And what they're seeing, and maybe you could comment on this, is actually that rather than food or otherwise, one of the best ways to improve your microbiome is actually not related to medicine at all. It's getting into nature and having a pet. Those were the two ways in which you could actually do it, because that was like the most microbes coming at you more than, you know, more than sauerkraut.
Well, actually, I mean, there's a lot of data, especially in childhood, of pets and being outdoors. There's also a tremendous impact of stress on the microbiome. And the studies, I reviewed one of them in my journal article, in which students who took a stressful examination had a significant change in the microbiome following the exam. So to some extent, the principles that are used by holistic and functional physicians in treating patients will be impacting on the microbiome in a positive way.
Awesome. Where's that mic, Paula? Okay.
Hi there. I'd like to ask a question as a patient. So as somebody sitting here about to turn 50, I lived a very active lifestyle, ate the right things, and yet recently I've suffered from Lyme, celiac, hyperthyroidism, and I'm someone who really doesn't run to drugs and medicine when something goes wrong. And my question, I hope, represents a question from a lot of patients, and I'll never have this kind of access again, so I might as well ask my question now, is where would somebody like myself go for a holistic approach to what's going on with me? And now that you really have me thinking about my gut in a whole new way, thank you, I wonder if there's something that you can help me with that could help other people.
Can I answer really quickly one thing that just point
Dr.
out
Gilovich,
that
what are you
Dr. Gilovich, okay. Actually, that no doctor title for me. But, you know, I just want to mention that Dr. Robin Berzin is reinventing a bit very soon the model of seeing a doctor, and she's doing a retreat at an eco-conscious inn in Rhinebeck, and it's a weekend spent with a doctor. And I think these conversations are very, you know, they need to be done over time and in retreat. So I just want to mention that, because I think that that's another model that is being placed on the table.
That's a good point, Paul. And I think, yeah, there are lots of opportunities for that. I would just say this is how it started for me. 15 months ago, I had my first opportunity to sit on this stage. And it was just as we launched Revive Primary Care. And Revive Primary Care, what we do is we basically try and put you in touch with someone who can help you to do this. So what we do is we educate patients on the four major causes of chronic disease that are modifiable by themselves. So the things that you can take care of at home, one of them is the gut, one of them is toxicity. We've spoken about stress and the microbiome, and then also talked about diet. These are things that don't require medicine, that you do in your own house, and they're not a part of the medical system. So we have education on that. And then we have a listing of practitioners by zip code. And that listing includes naturopathic doctors, it includes functional doctors. And over time, I hope that that will provide a blueprint starting point for people to find a primary care provider that can work with the causes of chronic disease and help you to avoid those. So I hope that's a good answer. Or you could go and see one of these all practice in Manhattan. One more question, Eric.
Yeah, hi, I'm Eric Goldman with Holistic Primary Care. So two quick things. One is there's been a lot of talk about functional medicine, and I just want to say a quick shout out to our friends at Institute for Functional Medicine, who've been doing this work and sort of crystallizing and pulling together all the intel on this for 20 plus years. And I know, Dr. Galland, you've spoken for, you know, IFM courses. And so, you know, I think definitely a little shout out to them. I was really struck, Robin, by your comment that you couldn't afford to see yourself and your friends can't afford to see you. And I think one of the big elephants in the room in this whole field is the question of finances. And it's hard to talk about, but, you know, the reality is practitioners do what they're paid to do, which is whether they're naturopaths or chiropractors or MDs or functional medicine practitioners, somehow or other, everybody's got to pay the bills. And so this challenge here is how do we make this either more affordable or increase the value so people realize that this is actually worth paying for out of pocket? Or the bigger question is how do we get into the level where the systems start to recognize the value? It's starting with the Cleveland Clinic. I think it's a great move, but there's a lot more work to do on that front. So I'd be curious what you all have to think about that.
I get how you speak, but I mean, I'm not sure if you were intentionally setting me up to talk more about the summit, but it seems like you were. Look, in the summit, we have amazing models of doctors that are doing this right. Dr. Shilpa Saxena, I met her at your conference. She's amazing, but she's doing functional medicine in a group style on insurance, and she's doing it in rural Florida. You know, Tom Blue, who speaks on the summit, is talking about, you know, the value of a membership model for working with patients as well, because, you know, you don't want the electrician or the lawyer working any longer than they have to because they're on the clock. But what if you took the clock away? How would you make different decisions when you're in your healthcare? And I think that's a big question, because people are a response to their environment. And if their environment is you have to pay a lot every time you go and see the doctor, they're not going to go. And especially men. Where's Gio? Is Gio in the house? Gio, the evolution of men's health tomorrow on the Evolution of Medicine Summit. The penis as a barometer of male health, right there. That's Dr. Gio. He's awesome. I'd love to hear your thoughts about that, but I do... Naturopathic doctor, exactly. Yeah. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. But the models, Eric, what you're saying, I think the people will respond to their environment, and models are being created right now. What has to happen is just the physicians to be able to have the entrepreneurial drive to be able to develop new models, and then to those to be proliferated out when they work. I don't know if you have other thoughts.
It has to start at the primary care level, because if you're waiting till people have complex, multi-system chronic illness, that's very time-consuming and it takes a lot of specialization.
Yeah.
So I think you're right there. Revive primary care is the slogan.
Thank you. Robin?
I mean, you bring up great points, and I just think that's what's been happening for the past couple of years. I mean, Obamacare, healthcare reform, getting rid of fee-for-service. I mean, we've hit a massive wall where we sort of recognize that we're about to in healthcare setting. So this goes far beyond functional medicine, naturopathy, integrative medicine, and just into health at large. And how do we flip the script and deal with it in a different way, both because the financial pressures are there, but also because the pressures from a dysfunctionally sick population are there. And so, as James said, I think there's a lot of interesting new models coming out across healthcare, across medicine, trying to figure out how we reinvent this. And that's why I actually love what Walmart has done in putting these primary care clinics in their stores. Say what you will about Walmart, but you know, for too long, medicine has been dominated by the hospital system. And right now, in the past couple of years, the hospital system is scrambling, trying to be everything for everyone. And they can't be that. They're really good at one thing. They're really good at acute care and emergency care and advanced level care, and that's what they should do. But that means that we have to create all these new paradigms of health and healthcare delivery out in the world, out in the community, where people are, where people live. I mean, we need kind of like the Starbucks of functional medicine to happen. And so in that sense, I'm actually really interested in what Walmart's doing, and I think it's a good, maybe it's not a model we've exactly followed, but it's inspiration at least.
We had actually a tweet from Megan Walker, who's also a naturopathic doctor in Canada, and she's watching, and particularly interesting to her because her husband he's a physician, and he's just been employed as the head of wellness at Walmart Canada, 600,000 employees. So, you know, if you could have that sort of influx in there, I think that would be a good starting point. Gabe, you want to add something before we finish up?
You know, what I would add is introduce yourself to the person you're sitting next to. You know, one of the reasons James and I created this event wasn't just for what goes on up here, but it was also about the people who are in the audience. I mean, it's really forward-thinking people that care about the future of healthcare. I mean, these are the important questions to be asking. And, you know, there are people here who are innovators, that are, you know, software designers, that are bloggers, that are journalists, that are doctors. I mean, there's so many interesting people here. And the idea is to bring us all together and ask these questions. I don't think anyone has the one answer right now, but it is an evolution, and it does evolve through communication and through all of us meeting each other and speaking to each other. And, you know, I'm very confident that that's going to happen, and you can see the direction it's going in. And, you know, before the iPhone existed, no one knew an iPhone was going to exist. Now it's here. Now there are apps being created. But clearly it's an issue, and it needs to be addressed. And I think rather than feeling helpless around it, I think it's just continue to ask this question to the people you're near, to people who maybe you haven't had that conversation with before. And, you know, the more we get together, the more we come to events like this, and the more we go out there and just be open and meeting people who maybe do something they're great at that we don't have a lot of knowledge about, and vice versa. I think that's how all, you know, great breakthroughs have come. And I think we're on the precipice of that right now. So
thank you, Gabe. I think that was a perfect way to wrap it up. And I would just say, you know, for patients, we've created Revive Primary Care for them to find a provider. For doctors, we're having this session right now. This is what the Functional Forum is. It is that conversation. And just as Gabe said, it already has borne fruit of innovators speaking to doctors and coming up with new ideas and models. And we hope to, you know, continue that conversation in the Functional Forum and accelerate the evolution of medicine. So it's been an absolute pleasure to have everyone here this evening. Thank you for taking time. I love everyone coming. I just want to leave you with one last thought before we go here, right? I came here in an Uber, right? I knew when I got into that Uber that I wasn't going to have to give him any cash. I knew it wasn't going to smell like a homeless person's urinal. And I knew that we would get here safely, and I knew that it would take the route. Now, this is a marked difference in the user experience of something that we've all had an experience with. And if you looked at salon.com last week, they were saying basically Uber's going to take over the world. And there were some concerns about that. But I would just say, we're in a time of dramatic change. You know, I asked Mark Hyman on the summit, you know, how are these organizations that, like Robin said, hospitals that are scrambling right now? You know, your local hospital, or the big hospitals that treat a lot of chronic disease, that could be the new blockbuster video. You see how quickly that went away? We're in a time of great change. The power structure is changing, and it's doctors doing it effectively and developing new models, and it's patients demanding this type of care. These people in this room today, and I'm looking particularly at you, press team, you have the opportunity to be able to. There is enough doctors out there right now to get started on this project. This project is starting anyway. Medicine is evolving. I'm not doing it. It's happening other way. It's happening all the time anyway. What we're looking to do is just to shine a light on those people that are doing it best and are setting up this new model of medicine. That's what the Evolution of Medicine Summit is. And I really want to thank all of you for being part of this tribe and being part of this community. It's a big part of ABC Home. What is home? It's about a community. It's about the microbiome. It's about all the stuff that we've spoken about this evening. I really appreciate you all being here. And I know that if all of us play our particular roles, we can accelerate this evolution of medicine. Good night.